See, the caves of Ajanta, it got developed in two phases. The first phase is datable to the 2nd century BC to 1st century BC. I like to call that Shravakayana phase. Sometimes people call it as Hinayana phase. That is not the nomenclature now the current scholars like to use, because it has some negative connotations. And the other phase happened about 5 to 6 centuries later, in the 5th century AD, at the time when Vakatakas were ruling in the region, particularly during the rule of Maharaj Harisena, which is datable from 462 to 480 AD, according to the chronology, short chronology of Professor Walter Spink. Regarding patronage, we have some very definite knowledge based on inscriptions and epigraphy. In the first phase, the patronage was collective. It was a community effort. The temples that were made in the first phase by collective patronage was cave 9, 10, 12, 13, and 15A, out of which cave number 9 and 10 are the temples, and cave number 12, 13 and 15A were the residential upashray for the monks to stay. And so these were developed in the earlier phase. And for example, the facade, the wooden facade was of cave 11, cave 10 was donated by one son of Vasishta, because there's an inscription that says, Vasishti putasa katahadi no gharmukh danam. That is, the son of Vasishti donated the wooden facade of cave 10. Similarly, in the same cave, inside there's an inscription by another person who donated the wall. So, and in cave 12, there is one Ghana Madad from Thana village, which is just near Fardapur, near Ajanta, not more than 5 kilometers. He is the person who donated the cave number 12. So this is how we know the collective donation. As far as cave number the caves of the 5th century AD is concerned, we have the names of some people. Like with respect to the cave 26 complex, we know it was donated by a very powerful Buddhist monk whose name we know was Monk Buddhabhadra. And that Monk Buddhabhadra says in his donative inscription that he excavated that temple complex in the honor of the Prime Minister of Ashmak Raja, whose name is given Bhavi Raj. And he says that I am in friends with that minister, that great minister, since several previous births. So it looks like that he was a monk, definitely. And he used the first person, you know, singular number. And he says, I have donated. That he's not saying that some other people have also donated. I have donated. So he had wealth and resources enough to be able to fund an entire temple complex. So what I'm trying to say is that his inscription is very much important. So epigraphy and archaeology both tell us that he was resourceful. And then we have somebody called Mathur who donated cave 4. Now, cave 4, as we know, is one of the largest vihara at Ajanta. So almost like 62 square feet, you know, just the hall itself, or 64 or 65 square feet. I have done the measurement, and there can be a small error in the figure that I'm subscribing. And therefore, we know, and then there is one Upendra Gupta. That Upendra Gupta is the king of the Rishika country, who donated the cave number 17, 18, 19 and 20. It is impossible to predict exactly what kind of tools and implement they did. But Professor Spink has been able to find that there are some iron implements still stuck inside the rock. And from that, and some of them went missing a few years ago, but and also from the chisel marks, somewhere on the rock, you will find the pointed chisel marks that will tell you that they had used some kind of heavy pointed chisels to hammer the rock out for the excavation, taking the huge boulders out from in the excavation process. And for example, for smoothening the surface of the walls or pillars, etc., or of the image or sculpture, etc., they use the flat chisels. So we are able to learn about some of these implements they had used. About the straight route, most of the ancient Buddhist pilgrimage sites were situated on trade routes. Say, for example, we have this Nala Sopara near the Bombay region, which is because this was a port area. And then you see, we have this Nanaghat. Near Nanaghat, we have this Bedsa caves, then Karla, then Kanheri. Kanheri is also here because it is the port area, it was the ancient port area. And then you have this Mahad, because an ancient route passed from here and up till going to other areas like Pitalkhora. There is also a pass in near Pitalkhora. From that pass, you climbed and went towards Pratishthan, which is near Paithan, you know, Rangabad, near Daulatabad, that Paithan. So this was an ancient trade route. Around this ancient trade route, you have all these Buddhists, because the traders are passing by, the merchants are passing by, armies is passing by, and invariably you have these ancient monasteries excavated and created near waterfalls, because you are going to need water throughout the year. So waterfall is there, and when people are passing on the Deccan, so in Deccan water is a huge problem. Even today, water is a huge problem. So the merchants and the caravans will pass on this trade route and will stop at these places which have these waterfalls. And they stay there, they take a halt, and they see this monastery, and they also give little bit in donation. So it is that anthropological relationship with the people, the merchants, the economic system, and the geography, even the geology, that regulated the proliferation of these monasteries quite often on the ancient trade route. Professor Walter Spink has done very extensive research, and now his study is compiled in 8 volumes he has published. I have also done a little bit of research in the last few years on site, which brings forth many kind of evidence. There is on-site of evidence, physical evidence, that many of the 5th century caves began rather simultaneously within the gap of a few years. Now, in the chronology of Walter Spink, it is he likes to put it from 462 AD onwards. So within a few years, majority of these 5th century caves, they start beginning, and by 480, the entire activity Ajanta comes to a close. More particularly, the two kinds of activities. One, that the excavation and the progress and the developments as sponsored and planned by the original donors, some of whose names are inscribed in the donative inscriptions. What happens in 477 CE, King Harisena dies. We do not know the circumstances how he died, but he dies. And Professor Spink says that these ashmakas created a treacherous kind of confederation of some disgruntled mandalikas, called mandalikas or feudatory kings, and they tried to usurp the whole empire, and therefore the empire collapsed. There was a very bad phase, and because of this lack of patronage that resulted after the death of Harisena, suddenly all of these caves that had started in the various years within this time frame during the rule of Harisena, suddenly they were facing problems. And some of the donors, they rushed to complete the and prioritize the shrine Buddha images, because in some caves, for example, cave upper six, even the floor is not ready. A large part of full floor is not done. Even the pillar is not ready. Even the walls in some cases are not ready, but they are rushing to complete the shrine. Take for example, in cave number 24, there was also a great rush. The entire floor is not done, unexcavated, the wall is not done, pillar is not done, but already they are completing the porch. And so there is evidence in all the caves. In cave 16 also, even the painting could never be completed. They started, there is a beautiful Nanda studio on the left side, the front wall they complete, the left wall, but the rear wall and the rear portions never got completed, but the shrine is complete, and there is evidence that there was a worship activity also. So there is a lot of, it will be very detailed account to speak of how things happened and what happened, but there is evidence that simultaneously things were happening. And then there is a research about the door modes, that is also a revolutionary theory of Walter Spink, and in which he is able to say that in which cell people actually lived, because there is a socket and in which the door was fitted, and due to the opening and shutting of the door, there will be wear and tear inside the socket holes of that pivot where the door pivot was attached. So if it is very smooth, then there is a proof that it was being used and somebody was living there. But inside the same cell, cave, or in other caves, you will find that there is no such evidence, which means that cave was never used. But this is one part of the evidence. Another part of the evidence is that there are hooks and holes on certain corners and in the center of medallions, and there is a wear and tear in certain areas. That tells us that garland was being hung. When the worship activity is going on, they will hang festoons and flags and the garlands. So that is a proof that worship was happening. In cave 1, you will not find any of this proof. And there is a third set of proof. That third set of proof is the carbon suit. Because from the lamps, the smoke will come out. And in cave 2, you will see from the shrine to the hall to the porch area, also in cave 11, you will find there is a deposit of carbon soot. Chemical analysis has been done. It belongs to 5th century AD. So none of this you will find in cave 1. So it's such a sumptuous cave, which appears to be so much complete, except the front wall. Front wall, the plaster was done, even part of the drawing was done, but the painting could never happen. So there is a large repertoire, gamut and corpus of on-site evidence that tells us that suddenly most of the caves came to a grinding halt, or rapidly the work was discontinued. As regards the painting program, recently, Professor Monica Zen, who is a specialist on Ajanta paintings, apart from Professor Shingloff. Professor Shingloff has focused majorly on the narratives, and Monica Zen has very closely studied the devotional and decorative themes of the Ajanta paintings. And she has recently published an essay which gives us a tremendous insight in how paintings were programmed. And she says that, well, there was a world of the yakshas, you know. And so once you enter the caves, you have these Dwarpalas, Bodhisattva himself, on the two sides of the door, in the porch, then in the hall, and then in the antechamber, and then again in the shrine, either in the painted format or in the sculpted format. So Bodhisattva is there, who is attending to the Gautam Buddha. Inside it is not some other Buddha. There are so many Buddhas. There are so many Buddhas, but it is not in Ajanta. What we have is the Gautam Buddha, not some other Buddha. There are hundreds and thousands of Buddhas that comes later in the Vajrayana tradition. In Mahayana also, there are many other gods and goddesses, but you will not find them at Ajanta. In Ajanta, even Bodhisattva comes very late. So in painting, you will find that there are many interesting aspects that comes. And these narratives also had a very interesting programming. Like these are like the narratives have these, like the Jatakas, as we say in the Pali canon, in the Shravakayana canon, and Avadanas, as we call it, the Mahayana canon. So these are like Buddha's past lives. Only Buddha can remember all his former existences. So once you have become the Buddha, then only you will be able to remember your past existences. And these stories of Buddha's past existences, have been painted in the Ajanta caves. See, Mara thing comes frequently in the history of Buddhist art and archaeology. Even for a devout Buddhist, whether you are an Upasaka or whether you are a Buddhist monk or you are a follower of Buddhism, Mara is very interesting. Who is Mara? Mara has been depicted in sculpture, very beautiful sculpture, on the left wall inside Cave 26 complex. And then Mara Vijaya is also depicted in the painted version in other caves. So this Mara theme is given a very important place in Ajanta. So what happens that at the time when Buddha is sitting under that peepal tree in Bodh Gaya for his last days, just before his enlightenment, that time this Mara, who is Mara? Mara is depicted as the god of the demons, you know, but actually Mara philosophically is the ignorance. Buddha is going to find out the nature of things, the true nature of things, the true reality of things, how this samsara is formed. He is going for enlightenment to find that perfect wisdom. And Mara is the incarnation of ignorance. So this is a bipolar forces. See, as regard the colors, people since the last one century or more, since the time the knowledge of Ajanta came to us after its rediscovery, many people have wondered the kind of colors that have been used in the Ajanta paintings. You know, we wonder because in cave number 9 and 10 that were painted in the 2nd century BC and the 1st century BC, and still these colors were so alive. You know, because when Griffith was there, when Robert Gill was there, it was fresh. They did the copies. And now, unfortunately, due to vandalism, the modern people, they wrote their names and vandalized and destroyed those paintings. Very unfortunately, we lost them. But you see, in other caves, like in cave number 1 and 2 and 16 and 17, and also in some other caves, for example, in cave 23 or 21, you have also some patches of color, which is so bright, which is so live. In cave number 4 also, on the porch ceiling, you will find some patches, which is so bright and as if it was painted yesterday. So many people wonder what kind of colors they were, because in thousands and thousands of years, these colors have survived. You know, also in even cave 11, in the porch, and outside the porch also on the ceiling, which is exposed directly to the sun and rain and heat and varying temperature and humidity, the colors have survived so well. So So earlier people thought that it is all vegetable color, you know, an earth color, like that people described the composition of the color. But let me tell you, now recently the science branch of the Archaeological Survey of India, they have done a thorough analysis, chemical analysis of these pigments. And there is a very, they have a very detailed knowledge which have been well published, you know, and they, and now we know that these were not so-called vegetable colors, because vegetable colors, organic colors will not last so long. They cannot last so long. So their analysis has found that it was the mineral color, the earth color, mineral color, you know, that they had prepared. And as a binding medium, they used various things. It is not exactly clear what was the binding medium, but there is a manager saying who was doing the conservation in Ajanta for some time. He was the in charge there, and he has done some analysis, and that analysis suggests that probably animal hide or some form of gelatin was used as a binding medium for these pigments, like mineral like terebinth and vermilion and things like ochre, you know, these are the things that were used. Regarding, you know, how the caves progressed, how the constructions happened, it is important to underline. You have to go to cave number 29, you know, to see how construction happened. You can exactly see how the construction happened in cave number 29, because from you start from the top, and when you are facing the cliff, then first you excavate the ceiling of the arch, and then you go inside and go into the full depth while you're still standing on your floor level, and gradually you dig out the floor and go downwards. So the process is the other way around, and you don't have to really, like Michelangelo, you don't have to do the other way around. So you have to remove the rock from under the earth and push it into the river. That is the process also seen in cave number 24. It's very much there in cave number 5 also, in cave number 14 also. So these incomplete caves are very instructive for us to learn how things progressed. But let me tell you in this context that it may appear from our observation today as if there was a given ready-made ground plan before the excavation and they completed the caves like that. Actually, it was not like that. You know, our research, Professor Spink and Yaguchi has also researched. I have also done some study in that. And collectively, it has become very clear to us that the plan changed in the course of time. When they began, the plan, the ground plan was something different, but as the work progressed, then they adapted to suit the different ideas, to meet with different ideas. For example, in the porch, earlier in the original plan, before the excavation, there was no idea of having cells on the left wall or the right wall of the porch area. It was only after a few years when they realized that we need more rooms, more cells, and this blank wall in the porch is just remaining unutilized. So they excavated the cell in the porch, even when there was no possibility to do so. And there is a proof in cave 17 on the left side, and there are many other proof. We cannot go into all the detail here, but that suggests that it was so. And one more thing I would like to point out, which also is a remarkable research of Professor Spink, and many people initially questioned, calling that it's all fictitious, but I have verified, many other people have verified, that initially cave number, many of these caves, like 1, 2, 16, 17, 4 and many other caves, were initially planned as upashraya, that is the residential hall. Buddha, they were not begun as Buddha temple. They were not planned as Buddha temple. Because Buddha temple was what? 19 and 26. We are talking about the 5th century phase, that time. Because they have the vaulted roof, and they have apsidal in their plan with a chaitya and an image inside. That was the temple. But this square plan with a flat ceiling, with aisles and square colonnade, this is the plan for a residential hall, which is popularly called as Vihara. Now, after around, let us say, within the framework of Walter Spink, you have this, they come about 467 or 469, around that time, they suddenly decide that we want to make a shrine there. In cave 11 or in cave 8, they, in the rear wall, they club together two cells and create a shrine. This idea probably came from Kanheri or Mahad. That experiment was already there. So architecturally, there was a lot of adaptation even while the excavation was going on. They changed the painting program, they changed the decorative program, they changed the architectural program. So Ajanta was a great laboratory of ideas.